Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. It's a Monday. The fifth one this week. Monday. How are you? 866-969-1969. 866-969-1969. Quick thanks to Dennis Paul, Daniel Pamatuan, Kevin McCardle with a big fat contribution to the Nick DiPaolo podcast. If you want to subscribe to that, go to connectpal.com/Nick. connectpal.com/Nick. $3.99 a month, five shows a week. We take the 2 hours here and boil it down to an hour for people who don't have Sirius, and people are still signing up and contributing on top of the $3.99 a month if you feel. And believe me, I could use it. Right now, I'm wearing 12-day-old underwear and a pair of red leather shorts that I used to wear in the 80s to high school. It used to get me a lot of snatch. Oh, yeah. Interesting weekend. Thank you so much to the great people of Arlington, Massachusetts on Friday night, the Regent Theater. It was tremendous. And then my favorite venue, even though I was picking on it, this is why I do this all the time. I make fun of the venues I'm in. Even at Tarrytown Music Hall is as sweet a little venue as you're going to find. And thank you people for coming out on Easter Eve. It was great. It's just an awesome venue, and the mic cut out a couple times, so I made a few jokes. But people in this business, folks, are very sensitive. It's why I don't belong here. When I say this business, I mean stand up, that type of world. It's all kids who get picked on and fat shamed, all that shit. They all run to show business. I personally had a good time in high school. I used to, you know, give people wedgies and noogies and fucking poke people in the eyes, and I just happened to be funny at the same time. So I've never been welcome in this business, let's be honest. But when you go to a local theater like this, that's who runs it. You know, a chick with a fucking glass eye and kind of a Sarah Sanders Huckabee look to him, and guys who weigh about fucking 106 soaking wet. And I can sense the, once the show's over, they're like, ugh, this guy stands for nothing. But that doesn't matter. The people who paid to get in, that's, and yeah, some of them drove a couple hours, had a few of those both nights, and it is such a pleasure to be performing in nice theaters, and, God bless comedy clubs. It's how you develop and stuff, and who knows? I could be back there in 2 months, but I'm just saying, to not be in a green room and, you know, fucking hear the noise of drunken idiots pouring into the funny bone and... It's nice when people pay real money, you know, no coupons, and they come in and they sit and they listen, and it's just a nice big stage most of the time with a curtain. That's all I want. And Tommy Nicky, God bless him, shows up at every gig, and it's been so. We're already this week coming. We'll be at the Red Hook Brewery in Portsmouth, New Hampshire on Friday night. And then Saturday night, April 7th, the Bottomon Opera House in Poughkeepsie, New York. That's halfway through the tour already. Frightening. Sir, I'll be dead in minutes. Next week, the tour continues on Friday, April 13th at the Paramount Theater in Rutland, Vermont. The next night, Saturday, April 14th, the Barrington Stage Company, Pittsfield, Mass. Go to nickdip.com for all the tour info, ticket information, and... I have a store there. If you want to get CDs, DVDs, hats, T-shirts, it's all at nickdip.com. So, but really fun gig, both of them. And it's just, there's nothing funner than smoking a cigarette in the alley after you're done by a dumpster. They all look the same, every fucking gig. A dumpster and, I don't know. It was funny. Easter Eve at Tarrytown had that Easter feel to it. The audience was a little, took me a while to crack them a little bit, but I wasn't all there mentally either. But the beauty of leaving my house, I go on Waze. This is why I'm a spoiled brat, though. I go on, you know, last weekend we were in Cuba, New York. That was literally 360-something miles or whatever away. I put in Tarrytown Music Hall from my house. It's like 14 minutes. And, oh my God, was home by like 5 or 10, even after shaking hands with people. I mean, with money in my pocket, folks, that's all I'm asking for. I'm not asking to be in the movies. I'm not asking to be Craig Ferguson with his own, well, when he had his TV show, Not asking to be Tom Cruise. Roseanne Barr. Just let me do this. Sell some tickets. Come see me live. That's all I'm asking. And, yeah, I cannot believe we're halfway through this friggin' thing already. The Nick is right, though. It's flying. 866-969-1969. Michael Imperioli of The Sopranos. He's got a new novel coming out, and it sounds very freaking interesting. Whole article always influenced by David Chase, which is true. I always talk about The Sopranos in this show, and I say what separates it is the details, the little things, everyday things. Like Tony, even though he's an Italian, he's an Italian-American, like taking turkey cold cuts and dipping them in the Hellman's jar and shit like that. Seriously, little shit like that. He's sitting there eating pasta like on a work day at noontime. He came home for summer, and his wife is like rubbing her, you know, putting her fingers through his hair like he's a little kid. Shit like that. Real life, almost, you know. That's what gives the show such depth. And the whole article was Imperioli saying that's, he never met a guy that worked, you know, and paid attention to such detail. But he's got a novel, debut novel coming out called The Perfume Burned His Eyes. It's Imperioli's book follows a Queens teen named Matthew as his shattered family moves from Jackson Heights to Manhattan, where he finds an unlikely mentor and a drug-addled Lou Reed, of all people. Early reviews have praised Imperioli for bringing mid-70s New York to life, with celebrated novelist Joyce Carol Oates hailing his work as vividly imagined. He's got a great imagination. He wrote the goddamn Pine Barrens thing and a few of the other. I mean, he wrote a lot of the episodes on The Sopranos. When it came to portraying Lou Reed, Imperioli had some of the best source material. The pair had been friends since 2000. They'd exchanged letters and did philanthropic work together. Imperioli, who also sings and plays guitar, even hung out with the former Velvet Underground frontman in the music studio. The actor knew he wanted to write a coming-of-age novel, but said he never thought to use Reed as a character until after the musician died of liver disease in 2013. He said initially it was just about the boy, the book. And then after Reed died, it just hit me. It was a moment of inspiration. What if this kid and Lou's paths crossed? I love Lou Reed. I love Imperioli. I am all over this shit. We got to get him in here. Said, hey, babe, take a walk on the wild side. And the colored girls go doo-doo-doo. Let's play some of the best of Imperioli as Christopher Down. This means turn it down. You can't do that?
Great, my own mother. Fuck you.
You said the second one we couldn't do. All right, kill Lou Reed.
You have to kill Kalu.
Oh, that's right, it's me. All right.
To the boss here.
Good, maybe someone will smack some goddamn sense into him.
Great, my own mother. Fuck you, you fucking whore.
He played a very charming.
Sit down.
Eat you fucking pig. Get off of me.
You fucking whore.
Fuck you.
Yeah, that's it. Go home. Get my dinner ready.
What a pleasant. Oh, so you could do it. No?
I just didn't think of it beforehand.
Oh, my producer. I'll tell you. Cocaine. So that's that. I can't wait for that to come out. It's in the next few days, right? That's going to be fucking great. Here's what he said about Lou Reed. Imperioli sees his novel as a homage to Reed, who could be a pretty prickly character, in quotes, but showed compassion, kindness, and generosity to those closest to him. Like me. Only not famous and not rich and not talented. Just like me. But I've met Imperioli a couple times. And in Vegas, we did the Wise Guy show or something. You know, a lot of the Sopranos guys were there. And Imperioli and Sharippa hosted it. And I did stand up. And then a couple weeks later, I get a voicemail on my phone. Hi, Nick. Is it Michael Imperioli? I almost shit myself. Maybe a few months after, I should say. He wanted for me to do some play with him, but it was about two, like, vaudeville comics, like, set in the 50s or whatever. And the dialogue was literally just me and the other guy, but there would be four pages of dialogue. Yeah, exactly. I was like, you know, the last time I acted, I think I said hello on Suddenly Susan as she was going out there. That's the extent of a, I'd done a few things, but I mean, I was flattered that I saved the voicemail forever, but I think I somehow, but because I love Imperioli. So I was flattered, but I could not handle that. I told him I had work or I had to do stand up. I couldn't afford not to take a few, but I could have not. It was, you know what I mean? Alan Alda would have struggled. It was like, you know, five pages at a time of, you know, looking into a mirror and talking to yourself and shit, like real. I mean, stuff that Paul Newman would have struggled with. I'm like, yeah. I have the chops of Larry Storch of F Troop. 866-969-1969 is the phone number. What do we got? We got Luke in Los Angeles on line two. Luke, how's your onions?
The biggest question I have about that book is, does anyone call anyone a mukyak?
I'm guessing chapter three, I think. Lou Reed's mother gets a little mouthy with Matthew.
Have that one called that one a mukyak.
That's, you did, Luke just hit the funniest part of it. Have that one call that one. That made me fucking belly laugh. Doesn't that sound like a good book, Luke?
I'd read the fuck out of it.
Yeah. I don't have to go that far, but yeah.
I got excited.
All right, anything else, fella?
Yeah, I'm out here in L.A., and I don't know if you ever heard of Nerd Melt Comics. It's
what is it?
It's called Nerd Melt Comics. It used to be where, what's his name, did the Nerdist podcast, Chris Hardwick.
Yeah, no, I tend to ignore that type of anything with nerd in it, but go ahead.
Well, it was a home base for comics that we love, like Kumail Nanjiani and Cameron Esposito, real funny people. But it's closing, along with a lot of these other places that are just like liberal echo chambers where like no free speech or any kind of free comedy is allowed.
Yeah,
and it just cracks me up that shit like this and like CISO and IO West just closed because these places they're more concerned with like exclusivity and having a diversity than actually having fucking funny people.
Well, hold on. Hold on. Let me push back on the CISO thing. I disagree with CISO. I mean, they had me on and Doug Stanhope and some liberal people, but they made an effort, I think. CISO did, no?
Well, I think they started cramming a lot. Like, I know that Cameron Esposito was on there, and she was constantly tweeting about, like, how diverse her staff and shit was. It's like, yeah, aren't even fucking funny? Because they weren't, but...
Right.
I don't know, maybe CISO you could argue, but it's just funny that places that use like meritocracy base and hire actual funny people like the Store and the Laugh Factory and the fucking Melrose Improv are going strong and all these new liberal fucking bastions of, PC safe space bullshit just go under. It's great.
Well, yeah, and Los Angeles is sort of the fucking ground zero for that horse shit. So, I mean, eventually the Comedy Store will go that way too. But yeah, no, that's you're right. And as far as the liberal radio never worked, they tried Radio America, whatever, with Marin and Janine, and the shit just like you said, it's an echo chamber. It's people saying what they think they're supposed to say, not what they're really feeling. Like this show, Luke. Good call. Talk to you later, buddy.
Love you.
I'm gonna turn the heat.
It is warm.
Yeah, I got a fucking sty under my left eyelid. Feels like I have a fucking, somebody left a wrench in there. Oh, it's just red and weepy and, not weepy, but it's, I got the sort of, like I said, the Sarah Huckabee Sanders thing gone. It looks a little, 866-969-1969. I'll talk about whatever you guys want to talk about tonight. I'm just, the fucking news is just recycled horseshit. I'll get to the teens who like to pull condoms through their sinuses. That's the new one. Because the Tide Pod thing was stupid. So, and this headline made me laugh. Five shot during incident Sunday night at underage rap concert in Mobile. Sound like a good idea to have any rap, mature rap concerts, these shootings. But let's give the fucking 15 and 16-year-olds a chance to show their marksmanship. And then Stephen Colbert... Easter Trump show on Showtime. He's got this animated thing, and the episode on Easter said, how do grown adults still worship Jesus? And there's dick jokes, Trump doing dick jokes about the, you know, about God cutting off his penis. And the point being is, can you imagine? I just laughed that that's considered edgy on the left. You know, because there's one religion causing havoc all over the fucking globe. But let's go after Christianity because they're real hellraiser. What fucking horseshit? That's called fake fucking edginess. And you'll find plenty of it in comedy clubs like Luke just talked about. Remember fucking Rosie O'Donnell? Remember the Pitbull? Comparing Christians to fucking ISIS. 866-969-1969. 866-969-1969. Teens snort condoms, then pull them through mouths. And disturbing the trend. And I, in all fairness, I did this once. I was like MacGyver one night. I was with a broad years and years ago. And I had a condom in my pocket, but apparently it had been there for about a year and a half. It was completely dry. So I had a cold. I ran it through, snorted it through my nose. I had a nice satisfaction, pulled it out my mouth. And that thing, it was fucking lubricated beautifully. Slapped it on my tool. So these kids, I wanted to yell at them at first, but... I don't know, pulling a condom, inhale it. They inhale it. This, to me, is kind of, you know, it's not as ignorant as a Tide Pod. Fucking
no,
shit.
They're ignorant.
No.
That's ignorant.
It's not ignorant. It's funny. Good for these kids. One of these kids that fucking does this will end up being, he'll be at the Laugh Factory selling out before my 38 years of stand-up. Because that's how it works in this retarded fucking world that we live in.
Uh-oh, retard alert. Retard alert.
I'd like to hear from some people who, I want to hear from some young kids who have done this at a party and ended up getting them laid. That's quite a trick. Who thought of that first? How bored are you? Are you that? I know a lot of millennials, take an oath of celibacy and shit. They're not like we were trying to fuck a neighbor's dog when we were 14. They, you know, they take an oath of celibacy. But how bored do you have to be sitting home like on a Friday night and go, you just take a condom out of the package and just, it's funny to watch. I go, there's a comedian who was up at Montreal like 15 years ago with me. He was like the headliner and that's all he did. He was like, he wasn't a magician. He was doing the shit after the show at Club Soda at the bar. He was pouring an entire thing of sugar in his nose, and then it would come out of his mouth completely dry. It was the fucking weirdest shit. See if you can find, you know, put comedian nostril sugar. I don't know how you fucking Google that. But I saw this. It made me laugh online.
Not amazing, Jonathan.
No. Fuck no. Amazing Jonathan he'd lay out a line, a fake line of coke. I remember watching him at Nick's. It was like literally 2.5 feet long. And, you know, it was fake and he had this giant straw and he'd snort it. But what people didn't know, he had like real lines of coke behind it. It was the funniest goddamn thing. He showed me like fucking between show. Just a maniac. Let's go to Brian in New Brunswick. What's up, Bri?
Hello, Nicky. How are you doing?
Pretty good.
Good, good. Oh, your caller guy. Is he Canadian by any chance?
No, but I am.
Oh, just, he's a fucking nice guy. Like, I thought he was from Canada. Jesus Christ. He's one of us. But, no, you were saying before you were looking for ideas for the show. I thought, well, I'm a trucker, and you got a couple others listening to you. I thought we could do an all-trackers show, guys calling in, telling stories.
Yeah, that sounds horrible. That sounds absolutely horrendous. I got to be honest with you, Brian. We can't, you know, we could do that for 10 minutes, but...
Well, I got good stories.
I'm sure you do.
I got the one night there, I threatened a male prostitute. Another time, I got caught jerking off in a truck.
That happened to me, and I'm a comedian.
No, it's like you did it on stage, though.
No, I didn't. I threatened a male prostitute, and then I got caught jerking off in a truck. Had nothing to do. Yeah. Well, we'll take that into consideration.
All righty, man.
All right, Bri. You stay safe now. Dale in New Jersey, welcome to the show. How's your onion, Dale?
What's up, Nick?
What's happening?
Hey, how you doing? You're talking about it pretty early, so I don't know. Like, I think probably the funniest scene in The Sopranos ever was Christopher's intervention. And
yeah, I just played a clip from it. Did you notice?
No, I missed that. Because the only thing I'm talking about is like that always sticks in my head is like when what's her name? His wife goes, "You are high at my mother's wake," and then Tony goes, "My mother's wake. Jesus Christ."
That's right. That's right. The other funny line was Silvio going, "I came into work early. Your head was in the toilet. Your hair was in the toilet water. Disgusting."
It was like, just, and Tony's like, just in his defense, he did have the flu.
Yeah, that's right. They didn't have the flu.
But, Nick, I have a quick while. Nick, go with me on this. With the whole thing with Trump is like, do you think it's officially happened now that the left, they're done, like, trying to go after him? Because after the Stormy Daniels thing happened, did you notice that nobody gave a shit? Not even the left. They were like, CNN put it, and they're like, it is what it is. We're fucked. All right, he's going to be the president for 8 years. What do you think?
Yeah, you know what, Dale? It's pretty good observation. I feel like it's it did fall off a cliff, that story. But CNN was like, I didn't see this, but I read an article saying CNN, like, all weekend, they were bragging about JFK's extramarital affairs and, you know, what a cannonball he was in bed. And you know, this coming on the heels of shitting all over Trump for having an extramarital affair, but they're bragging. They're like high school kids. This is a fucking news network. They can't see that people go, what are you, could you be any more hypocritical? It's just fucking, they're shameless, man.
I think it's officially done. I don't know what they're going to come out with after this, but I was just kind of like, okay, well, I think you're officially wrong. Good luck with the elections in 18.
Yeah, I think you're right. I don't know. They won't, as long as the mainstream media leans left, they'll always be in the game. Thanks for the call, Dale. Appreciate it, buddy.
All right, brother.
Later.
Yeah.
Mike in the Reno. What's going on, Mike?
Oh, not much. Talking about the same thing that guy was talking about, CNN shitting on Fox for having a bias almost exactly 2 weeks after interviewing a hooker trying to make Trump look bad.
Yeah.
I don't know.
CNN calling anybody, any other news organization bias is just fucking laughable on any level. And, you know, I pointed this out a while ago about the airports, how you forced to listen to CNN. I've been complaining for years because I hate public televisions anywhere in public spaces. That makes me nuts. But CNN, I mean, if you took away those, every Delta terminal has them. I'd love to know what their real number was ratings wise. 11
garbage.
People. The answer is 11 people.
It's even on my phone. The stuff that's automatic on my phone is straight CNN bias.
I know. How about when Yahoo News pops up? You're like, I didn't ask for your fucking left-wing opinion, you muddler's fucks.
Oh, fuck. Well, it's all fucked. We're screwed. But at least we got you.
Yeah, you're goddamn right, Mike. Thanks for the call, buddy.
Oh, yeah.
All right. 866-969-1969. Anybody snorting condoms? What you're supposed to do is smuggle condoms, cocaine in them, then you pull them out your ass, then you do the snorting. Maybe you don't even have to take them out now. You do the whole thing one shot. One more before we go to break. Josh in New Hampshire. Josh?
Hey, Nick, you doing trucker stories?
No, I'm not.
I'm trucking. I'm on a 3-day meth bender taking raw metal from Connecticut to San Francisco. Trucking. Woo!
Raw metal from Connecticut to San Francisco.
Woo!
Oh, beautiful. Tell me, I hope you're building houses for the homeless out there, or toilets.
Welcome. We love you.
All right, woo! Josh. All righty. You know what? He wasn't kidding. That guy was... That guy had a meth vibe to him. Ross Steele from Connecticut. Oh, I hope it's they're building a crucifix for Nancy Pelosi. Let's take a break, because I feel like punching myself in the fucking throat three times. We'll talk about gonorrhea that you can't get rid of. More good news in the world, huh? I'm sure that didn't come over the border, right? We've been killing that shit with fucking Raid for the last 40 years, but all of a sudden there's a super strong. Actually, the article's a guy got it in England, so who cares that fucking England, that fucking 98% Muslim shithole of a country. 866-969-1969. Back after this.
You're listening to The Nick DiPaolo Show on Faction Talk, Sirius XM 103.
I don't know. Stephen Colbert's Easter Trump Show. I guess he's got an animated show on Showtime. And they were, you know, the episode which aired on Easter Sunday was titled Church and State and depicts a fictional Trump grappling with his loss of support among evangelical voters. On an open mic, he is heard committing the religious gaffe. And the line was, what's that, Joseph guy, a putz or what? Clearly he wasn't taking care of Mary's needs. I mean, if God knocked up my wife, he'd never doink again. I'd cut off God's penis, Trump says.
Who said that? Who the fuck said that? Who's the slimy little communist shit twinkle toed cocksucker down here who just signed his own death warrant?
Yeah, that would be Colbert or his writers, whatnot. But he's supposed to be a devout Catholic. So, but I think his only religion is money, if this is what he's behind. Fucking. The point being, you know how coward fucking. There's one religion causing havoc around the world right now, and it ain't the fucking Christian one. So it's such. This is fucking considered edgy. If you go down to the, you know, the comedy clubs in Manhattan. I can laugh at all this shit, but on Easter, and so, I mean, really? Couldn't do a little Islam fucking humor? Colbert, you might fucking, what, end up with your head on Kick Down Broadway by Mahmoud Muhammad? Then Vice President Mike warns the president, sir, I think that's a hot mic. Trump does not believe him. Why is there a cold breeze on me tonight? What the fuck has changed? Does this change? On the air, come warm, whatever. Pence says, I think that's a hot mic. Trump does not believe him, and the anti-Christian insults continue. You think your great-grandfather hunted dinosaurs. That's what Trump says to Pence. How do grown adults still worship Jesus? I mean, where was Jesus when the Taj Mahal was at a standstill with the unions? Which, that's a funny line. But the point being, it's ballless. Make something, say something about the fucking Prophet Muhammad on your cartoon. After the gaffe hits the news, Trump tells the public, don't believe the dishonest media. I would never cut off God's penis. This is Easter humor, by the way. Unless God, and by the way, Showtime. Again, would they ever put anything up? Fucking just cowardly, spineless, motherless fucks, each and every one of their goo-gobbling fucking. I would never cut off God's penis unless God begged me, like, please, son, slice off my dong. I'm like Jesus, only with twice as many prostitutes. Later in the show, Trump's son decides to create the alternate religion of Trumpanity. God gets hit with a golf cart and Trump wins an Easter egg roll by cheating.
Shut up! Shut up!
Brought to you by Stephen Colbert.
You smug cocksucker. Fuck you.
I mean, man, come on, man. Real ballsy, huh? Let's go to Brian of California, the last Republican in the state, he believes.
What's up, Nick?
Hey, Bri.
I just wanted to touch base on some of this left shit that I'm starting to hear now where white folks apparently don't have to do anything because some rich man will come sponsor us and help us out. Makes me feel like I don't do shit. And it's just part of their propaganda to kind of get other ethnicities on their side and kind of hoo-hahing about their bullshit.
What are we talking about exactly? You lost me at the beginning, Brian. I'm sorry.
Like, this whole thing with white entitlement. Like, what I'm supposed to believe is because I'm white and I grew up in America. Everything was handed to me. I didn't try for shit because apparently there's rich white males that are powerful sponsoring people like me and helping me out. It's just another one of the left agenda things that I keep hearing about.
You know, you don't believe you're a white privileged male?
I don't. No.
Me either.
I mean, I work 50 hours a week. I paid for my education. I didn't bitch about my student loans. I just paid them off. Nobody did it for me.
No, but see, they'd go, oh, right there, you had a job. Somebody helped you get a job. And you had an opportunity to go to college, even though you paid for it, you had the opportunity. That's what they'd come at you with. Like, you know, they have none, which is total horseshit. Maybe in 1948, none of this was, but it's all available to them now. And they're still crying fucking victimhood. So you're right.
Well, I mean, am I supposed to feel bad because my parents stayed together and didn't shit the bed?
Yes, you are, as a white man.
It's like, fuck, man.
Don't let it get to you. Don't let it. You know what? Bri, do what I do. Handle it the other way. I go, fucking, you rub it in their face. Go, yeah, I'm a fucking white male. It's great. Fucking enjoy your day at the shithole. I mean, enjoy it. Be the if they're going to paint me as an asshole, I'm going to act like one, which I've nailed that role pretty good on stage. But don't let it get to you, bro.
Yeah, I won't, man.
All thanks, right.
Nick, keep up the good work, man.
Take care, pal. Oh, for the love of, I mean, I used to, but I'd love that. What's it? I would love to hear that. I used to say, yeah, I'm making at the Comedy Cell, I'll be on stage. I'm the white privileged male. Hey, I'd go to, hey, Noma, whoever's in the room. What do we get paid for this set tonight? And what did Godfrey get paid? The same. I get the same as the black guy? All right. Just want to make sure everybody realizes that. don't let it get to you, folks. Do what I do. Go home and quietly go to the liquor cabinet. Here's what my guy, this guy Phil Toll, I used to work with. He used to smoke like four packs a day. He was a phone salesman. Had this. People would just send him money over the phone because his voice was like 19. It was the greatest voice. He was a stone call. We'd go out to, you know, lunch. He'd have, you know, five martinis and not even fucking feel it. And he got divorced because of his drinking. And he told me, though, near the end when he was with his wife, he used to drink martinis when they were watching TV, and she used to fucking bust his balls. So he said, he told her he quit drinking. What he used to do, he'd buy jars of olives, dump the juice out, and replace the juice with vodka, and then sit there watching a movie with his wife, pretending he's, you know, drinking the olive juice out of the... Which is fucking ingenious. I mean, old school. One of these guys, I bet you he'll live till he's 106. He had a sailboat, and he goes, yeah, I'm going on vacation for a week. He was going to sail down to St. Martin. Comes back 6 months later. Like, I don't know, 40 pounds heavier with just booze. And love guys like that. I look up to him. The Andy Fioris of the world. Well, that's a dangerous situation. Hey, I don't like the law that I can't drive around with an open booze thing in my, even though I didn't drink out of it. If I have a, let's use an example, a bottle of Bacardi. And they pull me over and that's my bet, and I haven't touched it, right?
State to state, I think, still.
But New York is one of those states, is it not?
Correct, yes.
This fucking state that just, you know, makes you wait 8 years to get a handgun and can't have an open, who the fuck's running it? Some 9-year-old broad on the, I was going to say on the rag, that made no sense. Paul in Mississippi. Paul, how are you?
I'm good. How are you, Nick?
Pretty good.
I was, I know it's, the screen still said about the gonorrhea thing, that's why I called in. But, I was telling Brendan that, you said before we shouldn't be going over to Southeast Asia and doing all those broads over there. But when I'm sitting in the Indian Ocean for 120 days, surrounded by 1,000 men, the first woman I see, she's going to get through.
That's a good point, I guess, Paul. It's a good I don't know if I'd take a clean guy's ass or a filthy Indonesian vagina.
I will not take a clean guy's ass. I screwed women in Korea, South Korea, Thailand, Philippines, Japan. Pretty much anything over in Asia, they got screwed.
And did you put condoms on?
No.
And you never got
anything? I'm going to feel a sensation.
Did you get anything, Paul? Did you catch the drip over there?
No, I got BD from an American girl when I got back.
Yeah, she was probably with some South Asian chick rubbing clitch.
Oh, by the way, go Bruins. Gotta talk about my Bruins. I love my Bruins.
All right, baby. All right, Paul.
Thank you very much.
You got it, buddy. So, Paul, never got the... I'm guessing you're in the minority. I mean, they have films about it the minute you get in the military. And I don't think those are English chicks in the films. Me so horny! Me so horny. Let's go to Mike in New York. You have Facebook story. I don't even know what he's talking about. Go ahead, Mike.
Oh, yeah, sorry. I've been listening on demand. I haven't had a chance. So I'm just bullshitting.
Yeah, we can't talk about shit that happened the last show, Mike.
So. No, but it's important. But here's the thing, man. You're talking about, I'll change it up a little bit. here's the thing, because I was interested. I was listening to Sam Morril, who I love. But even him, like, as a white comic, he started kind of going like Liza Traeger on you. Like, he just, these comics I see, and he's a great comic, get brainwashed and done stuff.
Yeah.
It's like ridiculous. Like, I can personally hear him talking like that shit he doesn't believe. He just saw it on news, saw it once in a while, and that's what he believes. And that's what the comics are becoming, even if good comics, because it's like they have to survive.
Well,
Sam
grew up in Manhattan, so he grew up liberal, you know. So I don't say he doesn't believe that, but some of it was like when I told him that Facebook, you know, social media leans left and he didn't know, that's called, like my buddy Colin Quinn says, willful ignorance is what it is.
Yeah, I guess you don't want to know. But the thing I was trying to say, because the fact like that they're coming after Mark Zuckerberg, that's a huge deal because he was supposed to protect Hillary, you know, and he didn't. So now it's like, let's blame him to make Trump look bad. They're willing to go after Zuckerberg to take down Trump. That's how big of a deal it is, in my opinion, because I know everyone kind of knew Facebook had some privacy stuff. I mean, whether how big you knew it was, that's just their business model. But now the fact that they're willing to expose it, they're willing just to take down Trump. That's the sole reason. And that's kind of disturbing for me, because who knows what they're going to do.
They're going through... I'm trying to follow your logic. They're going to take down Zuckerberg to get to Trump?
Well, the whole thing is that they're trying to relate that Facebook, this whole stuff about their privacy, people voted for Trump because they got tricked with data and stuff. That's their next play,
right,
in my opinion.
Right.
So it's like, so they're willing to not protect Zuckerberg anymore with his privacy shit because they think it's going to hurt Trump. That's my opinion. And I think it makes sense a little bit.
Yeah, well, I don't think Zuckerberg's going anywhere. He's one of those,
he lost, not that he needs it, but billions of dollars. If you think about it, it's a pretty big deal, you know?
I know, and then it rebounds fucking 5 months from now, you know, because somebody says something else. That's so weird, isn't that nice? Who lost, Bezos and Amazon, you know? He lost, like, literally, I don't know, $40 billion with a B. And, you know.
Yeah. Well, it's time to buy then. Get on that Bitcoin, too.
Yeah, that's right. All right, Mike. Good call. All right. They're not going to, you know, Zuckerberg. I think they're going to try to regulate all this shit, whatever. But guys like that, where's he going? Were they going to put him in jail? What? Huh? See you at 3 o'clock, buddy, as my teacher would say, for an hour of detention. Fiore is glued to that Villanova fucking... You'd think he had money on it.
I have heart.
You got fucking heart. Your heart is blacker than my sister's napples. Those are nipples and apple.
That's a...
Napple. What are you going to find my apples? Dave in Iowa. How are you, Dave?
Hey, Nick, what's up, brother?
Nothing. I'm all over the map tonight, Heavy. So I'm letting the... It's going to be Manic Mondays. You guys can decide. I'll just react to it. I'll make it entertaining and funny. That's the kind of...
Okay. Well, you kind of touched on it. I was curious that these women have made such a big deal out of wage disparagement, which I say it's probably a real thing, but in my world, it's not. You know, everybody makes the same. And I was wondering about the comedy deal. I mean... Do they pay a female comic less just because she's a female? That's my question.
I doubt that very much. In this business, what are you kidding me? Matter of fact, I know a few get paid better than I do. Then they're more famous than me. But no, Fiore can speak to that because he's on that level. They make $11 a set. Go ahead.
Yes, absolutely not.
You get paid the same, right?
Of course.
Yes. Yeah, no.
Okay,
although,
where did this number, is it?
Although, Dave, I was going to say, the Monique thing, right? Netflix only wanted to give her so much, and she went shithouse. But again, because it's based on a free market, and she was only going to draw so many eyes to the thing. What?
I was going to say, correct. That's the perfect example of quality demands. Because she screamed racism.
That's called
racism,
the free market.
She screamed sexism, but then she named two black guys and a woman.
Right.
Who got bigger money.
Bigger money than her. Right.
So,
yeah, the free market is, but it, the answer is no.
All right, sir.
All right, Dave.
Well, next time be more funny.
Be more funny? Why?
I don't know.
You
make DiPaolo, man.
Yeah, well, I know, but Jesus Christ, Dave, does that mean everything out of my mouth has to be a joke?
Well, you said you were going to make it funny. So.
Oh, I see. All right.
Yeah.
Only the girls with big tits get plenty of money, Dave. All right. Take it easy. Fucking hayseed. Jesus. Did I put that in writing? The show was flying by, and then I hit a mud puddle, and the car stalled. nobody told me this is a... Let me read a headline that made me laugh. Five shot during incident Sunday night at underage rap concert in Mobile. Why would you have a rap show, an underage rap concert? Not to draw too many, you understand? The people who are of age... doing enough violence when there's a rap concert. But let's let the 15 and 14-year-olds, who are probably the fucking craziest, shooting happened at the Grand Hall. Are we playing that on Nick is Right Tour? I hope the fuck not. Shots were fired outside the hall around 10:40 p.m. during an event involving mostly teenagers. The event was advertised as a rap concert for high school students. How the hell? Why? I don't care if you think I'm making generalizations. How the fuck do you think that was going to go off without somebody going, I've been shot? One guy shot himself, they said. Seriously, self-inflicted. And then somebody else is like in critical. Five people struck by bullets. And at least two more were hurt in a stampede of people trying to flee the shooting and get inside the building. Of the five shooting victims, one person's injury was self-inflicted. Another individual who was... guy got so nervous, he goes, I'm going to shoot myself. and another individual who was shot by someone else is in critical condition. Police arrived at the scene around 11 p.m. where they described seeing approximately 300 teenagers between the ages of 15 to 18 years old. But nobody's mentioning it. I don't know what color these people are. They haven't mentioned race in this article once. Police Chief Baptiste acknowledged that the spring break timing may have been a factor. Oh, yeah, that's what it was. Since children in Mobile would have been off Monday. You got to have that on Christmas Eve. Fucking Flag Day. Arbor Day. Fucking Halloween. Easter. Maybe it was Easter. But I like the police chief. He says, this is a plea to the parents to be more vigilant. First of all, it says parents, plural, which is hilarious. To be more vigilant where their children are hanging out at. To be sure they are going into a safe environment. Well, back in the day, going to a concert was a safe environment. That those established have safety protocols in place. Can you imagine being a parent? You're on the phone going, hi, yeah, I'm going to send my friend, my son to the rap concert tonight. Do you have safety protocols in place? Do you have two clearly lit exits? The parking lot was strewn with mostly garbage, but evidence of the rush to escape the hall was clear. Clothing, footwear, cell phone cases, and chargers could be seen on the ground outside the venue. At the rear of the parking lot next to a bar, a small bag of marijuana was found on the ground. You sure this wasn't the Pistons locker room?
Shut up! Shut up! Shut up!
I'm in mood for Uncle Junior.
Guy comes home with a bouquet of flowers for his wife. I guess I'll have to spread my legs now, she says. Why, he asks. Don't you have a vase?
What'd I tell you? Hold on to your cock when you negotiate with these desert people.
Oh, come on, Andy. No piling on.
That's Uncle June.
Yeah, I know. Gotta be stealthy. We have to dole out our... I feel bad for the police chief. To the parents, be more vigilant where your children are. So you're having a fucking rap concert for children. When are you not a child? Can I ask at what age? Seriously, I'm asking this seriously. What point? I mean, they're looking at porn at age 4, 5. I don't know. Matt in Arizona, what's going on, Matt?
Hey, Nick, you know, the worst thing about this shooting in Mobile is that it's going to go down, as far as the FBI is concerned, as a mass shooting. So it's just more ammo for the left-wing.
Yes, the anti-gun people. What's the definition of a mass? 4 or more, Matt?
Yeah, I think it's 3 or 4, yeah.
3 or 4. That's a Tuesday night in Chicago at a goddamn bingo game.
Yep, exactly. But it happened in one location and probably with either one or two weapons.
That's a good point. And they'll throw that in the category.
Yep, that'll just get lumped into the mass shooting category.
Yeah.
But hey, Nick, one more thing. One of the funniest goddamn things I've heard you say in my 6 or 8 months of watching this show, the chick from Notre Dame, the chick who hit the game winning shot when you made up a name for her, holy, I almost fucking pissed myself.
Well, it was a very, I think it was like an African name. But let me tell you about that woman. She has ice in her veins. That's like two games.
She is, yes. He's a cold-blooded murderer. I
wouldn't go that far. Jesus. That's not pie wine. She plays for the Irish, obviously. Ricky Ogunbowale. Bang!
I was driving in my car. I swear to God, I almost pissed myself. It was fucking hilarious.
What a shot that was. All right, Matt. Thanks, buddy.
All right.
Seriously, though, that fucking... She won two games at the buzzer like that. Again, shooting from her tits. Pretty sure I could slap it away. Anyways, ladies and gentlemen, this weekend, Red Hook Brewery, the Nick is right talk and continues at the Red Hook Brewery, Portsmouth, New Hampshire, on Friday night. Saturday night, the Bar Divine in Poughkeepsie, New York. And then next weekend, the Paramount Theater, Rutland, Vermont. April 14th, the Barrington Stage Company in Pittsfield, Mass. April 20th, the Cortland Repertory Theater, Cortland, New York. April 21st, Steel Stacks, Bethlehem, Pennsylvania. April 27th, the Majestic Theater, Pottsville, Pennsylvania. April 28th, the Kirby Center, Wilkes-Barre, Pennsylvania. And then May, Jonathan's in Agunquit, May. Have you been in Agunquit? Beautiful, beautiful area. It's like a predominantly gay hangout.
Perfect.
And I spend from June to August there just... and then May 5th, the Schubert Theater in New Haven, Connecticut, which I was told is already selling well. Go to nickdip.com for all the ticket information. And you can buy podcasts, hats, t-shirts, CDs, DVDs. Thank you to all the callers tonight. You were great. You're the lifeblood of the show. Remember, kids, you think it, I'll say it. You're welcome. Talk to you tomorrow.